The idea is to talk about your optic-oriented ontology, speculative realism, and one first question would be, you developed that concept in Cairo. Did that place, did that environment in Cairo make you think different or make you develop that theory different, since this culture or this city is very much based on things happening at once? There is a dense moment of agency happening all over the place, and not only by people but also by things.
Object-oriented philosophy is something I began to develop in the 1990s in Chicago, the late 1990s, while working on my doctoral thesis. Cairo has been very useful in helping me develop it, primarily because it's good to be away from the centers of Western discourse, because the dominant doctrines of the preceding generations are still at work there, and it's good in some way to be separated from that. Just as they say that evolution happens more easily on islands in biology, this is also true in an intellectual sense. It's been good to have a kind of alibi to not have to go to these American meetings of Society for Phenomenology and Existential Philosophy and these other repositories of previous innovative doctrines that are not necessarily innovative any longer.
How would you describe the difference between living objects, living entities like plants? You said your wife is a biologist dealing with microbes, as far as I understood. And of course, there are lots of microbes here all over the place, yeah, which are living entities.
Yes.
And we cannot see them, we cannot perceive them as living entities without any technological or scientific background. But they are there. Is there a categorical difference between living entities and non-living objects as we have it around here?
I would say that there's a difference, but I don't think that difference should be the starting point of philosophy the way it is for many moderns. Many moderns will say you have human thoughts and then you have absolute inanimate matter, Descartes being the most extreme version of this, where animals don't even have feelings. You can torture a monkey with a knife and its screams are just like the squeak of a wheel that needs more grease. This is the harshest form of it. So I think something obviously needs to be said about the difference between humans, animals, plants, microbes, inanimate objects. I simply don't think that should be the first step. The first step should treat everything equally as an object, as something that withdraws from its actions, unlike in actor network theory where a thing is defined by its actions. Now, how you do that is an interesting question. From reading Uxku recently, again, I was reminded by one of his ideas, which is that life is characterized by its stupidity in the sense that a stone can enter all kinds of interactions with other objects, but a muscle reduces everything to a contraction. And so in a way, life has a kind of stupidity that reduces many excitations to one result. So that's one thing. As for what makes humans different from animals, I'm more sympathetic to the idea that it's history rather than language, because we find all kinds of examples of language in animals, not so many examples of history. But then from rereading Freud again recently, I'm wondering if repression is not what characterizes humans the most. But the difference between unconscious, preconscious, and conscious, characterized by their various relations to repression, something you probably don't find so much of in the animal kingdom.
I read on Wikipedia that you have a background as a sports reporter as well. I'm not sure if it's true.
It is true.
So you're good in commenting and in observing and in reporting in a way. So would you mind reporting for 5 minutes what's going on here?
Yes. We're in the garbage city in Cairo. And amazingly, after all my years in Cairo, I've never been in here. So I'd like to thank you, Daniel, for that. I've heard about this place many times. It's been in the news with some controversies about the slaughter of pigs and other issues. And now I'm here finally, and I see where all of my garbage has been coming for the last 16 years. My first impression is that it's all a lot cleaner than I would have expected. This is plastic. Much of it has been eaten off of. Yet there's a fairly limited number of flies, considering that we're in a garbage dump city. But they seem to have pre-cleaned this somewhere, because there's not a lot of food residue. It looks pretty wholesome. And the gentleman just told me that they are recycling this and sending it to China. So there's a really global globalization dimension to this. China is going to end up with the final plastic product of this.
Written on here, made in China, and it maybe goes to China, part of it. Yes.
Interesting. So it comes from China and returns there. All right.
What is the anthropocentric dimension, or the anthropocenery dimension of this place?
Well, I assume that most of this material could not have existed until less than 100 years ago. That's one thing. This immense amount of garbage, plastic plates and cheap plastic containers of this sort are a fairly recent invention. And I'm glad that it's going to China instead of to that Pacific Ocean garbage patch, where otherwise it might have ended up. I have this idea about the Anthropocene that the climate has become Anthropocene whenever they say it started. That's still not resolved. It could have been the Industrial Revolution. Some say it was the shift to agriculture. Some say it was the atomic bomb. So that's still an argument. But many objects have been Anthropocene all along. For example, arts. I think art is Anthropocene because I don't think you would have art if all humans were exterminated. So humans are dependent on art in that sense. Wanna go? Okay. I think humans are dependent on art in that sense, even though I do think there's a depth to the artwork that is not penetrable to the human gaze, that is not penetrable to the beholder. So I agree with the formalists about that much. I simply disagree that the idea is to get rid of humans completely, so that art would simply become about some speculation about what the world is like after human life. Some of the other speculative realists have tried to go in this direction, and I'm not sure it's productive. I think you need to have a human there. Basketball. You can't have basketball without humans, ever. Doesn't make any sense. And now the climate has gotten to that point. The climate has become Anthropocene after many other objects were Anthropocene. Human society has always been Anthropocene in the sense that human society without humans doesn't exist, yet society is still deeper than the sociologist's knowledge of it. There's that duality. And we're getting to that point now with the climate, that there is no climate apart from the human interaction with it.
What do you think about the term of the hyperoptics by Timothy Morton?
I find it very.
Do you agree?
Yes, I find it very inspiring, and I'm going to make use of that this summer in an essay on prehistory that I've been asked to write. And I'm not sure exactly what my conclusions will be yet, but I think Tim Morton, as someone has pointed out, has an amazing gift for coining neologisms. A lot of his words stick around as terms that other people use, and I think hyperobject is one of those that's destined to stick around. But yes, I can see the Anthropocene as a great example of a hyperobject, something that's completely, we participated in causing, yet is completely beyond our capacity to visualize. I'm reminded of the contest some years ago when they our design competition, when they asked people to design illustrations for nuclear waste sites, and I forgot what the time period was they were talking about. Let's say it was 20,000 years. It has to be something understandable 20,000 years from now. And you cannot assume that those people are going to be more advanced than we are. That was one of the conditions of the competition. And as I recall, what they ended up with was a series of stick figures digging into the ground. Underground the whole time were these lines representing dangerous radiation. Those lines eventually come up to the ground, and one of the stick figures drops over dead, and then the other. And then I think the final panel was amongst the scream. So I guess they think that the scream is going to be intelligible thousands of years from now to anybody, even a more primitive form of human that might exist then. So maybe Munch's painting is a hyperobject of sorts. It's able to coexist along with the lifetime of the radiation so that any human who happens to be alive then can interpret the radiation with the aid of Munch's painting.
All over the place you've got religious icons.
Yes.
And I think this place would not work without religion as an object, maybe. Mm-hmm. Could you interpret or would you consider religion or these artifacts as objects, and could you describe the impact on this situation?
Yes. First, I should say something about what objects mean in Tripolo or object-oriented ontology. A lot of people come to us already having prejudices about what object means. They think it means a solid physical thing that can be moved around without alteration. They often think it means something durable, something inanimate. For me, object simply means something that is not fully reducible in either direction, either downward to its pieces or upward to its effects. It cannot be duomined, as the terminology is. It cannot be undermined, cannot be overmined, but it has a certain reality that resists in both directions, its composition and its effects. And so all kinds of things can count as objects, including imaginary things, including humans, and even a religion, because a religion can withstand certain pressures applied to it. A religion can surprise us by showing new aspects we hadn't realized before. Icons, of course. And this is known to be a Coptic Orthodox neighborhood. And this is what a lot of the pig controversy orbited around, because, of course, Muslims are not allowed to have any dealings with pigs, which they view as dirty. There was that religious undercurrent to that controversy. And these icons are especially wonderful. And I suppose in a place like this, you would want some kind of higher backing.
Regarding matter, would you regard data as matter as well? Yes.
Certainly. As long as it's not reducible in one of its two directions. Mm-hmm. And I'd say that it's not, because data can also surprise us. Even though it seems like an obviously visible mathematical fact, it has some impenetrable aspects. You can, they data mine, right? People data mine, which means not everything there is evidence at first.
Yep.
So it's an object.
And when does data turn to waste?
When does data turn to waste?
Is there a waste concept for data? Does it make
there
sense
must,
to there, think in waste terms about data?
There must be, because we all throw out data sometimes.
So on trash bin on our computer desktop.
We do. I regularly throw things in the trash each day on my desktop, just as in my physical wastebasket. Sometimes someone sends me a piece of writing and asks me to comment on it. I can't keep all that stuff, so I usually only keep it if it's something I'm going to quote again.
Yeah.
I can always get it back out of my Gmail account if I need it later. So a lot of that is...
Of course, we know that it's stored, and maybe forever. Yeah.
That's true.
The internet doesn't forget. We know about that. It'll so maybe we regard things as rubbish or waste and
yes.
throw it away, but in fact it's still there. So it's like the plastic.
Yes.
Morton says there is no away anymore. Yeah.
Right.
There is no U-bend in the toilet anymore that you can say something is gone.
Yes.
Yeah. You sort all the matter with your hands, with your blank hands. You don't wear any gloves. And then they said, yeah, we need the hands since the tactility. We need to grab it, and we're thinking with our hands.
Mm-hmm.
And then I was mentioning the bacteria, and he said, no problem, mafis mosqueda, since the bacteria is inside of our body.
Mm.
Yeah? So that would be also in an excursion understanding maybe that we are embedded in a certain environment,
yes.
we become part of the environment through our metabolism.
Yes.
Yeah? So this is an extended metabolism for these people. Description fits to your thinking.
It fits just fine.
Prehension maybe, whitehead.
Yes,
get into things.
Yes.
Hyperoptics, which are in our body and out of our body.
There's often a misunderstanding that object-oriented philosophy only wants to deal with solid things, and therefore we're not interested in multiplicities that are inside of a thing, but that's not the case. There's no final level of objects for us. All kinds of composite entities can be objects, and that includes, for example, the unification of the individual with our associated microbial community. And I understand there's a new theory of evolution from within the last 10 years that says that is the unit of natural selection, not the individual. The individual plus the microbial community inside the individual's body is the unit of natural selection. So you could be a robust individual in your own right, but something's wrong with your microbes, you're not going to survive, because they're your first line of defense. I think the other evidence in favor of this theory is that we cannot evolve fast enough to deal with changing environments, but our microbes can. And so that's why we need them as a first line of defense. And so if you kill them off, you're abandoning that aspect of your body, which isn't really you. As for these people here, I didn't have time enough to observe them closely. Are they? I assume they're sorting by types of plastic, right? At first I thought maybe shapes, but then I realized that would make no sense. It has to be type.
The material, the matter.
So they can melt them all together by type. And
it's rhetoric and melt it together. Yeah.
Okay.
Plastic theory by Joseph Beuys.
Mm.
You heard about that?
I know Beuys well, but I don't know that theory.
Well, that was his theoretical thing that things get melted and transformed again. And then he also developed the concept of the honey, what we call it, the honey pump,
mm-hmm.
the honey machine. Since honey stands for living and eternity and so
mm-hmm.
on, he applied the concept of honey to human society
mm-hmm.
very much.
Okay.
And that reminded me when I was reading Morton,
mm-hmm.
and he was talking about viscosity
okay.
As one of the concepts or one of the features of an hyperobject is viscosity. And Jean-Paul Sartre once said that viscosity is like, it's best described by putting your hand into a jar of honey.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe creating a kind of an intercorporeal reality
mm-hmm.
with the matter. And evolving yourself within that matter.
Yeah. It's interesting that you mentioned honey, because that reminds me of our previous topic as well. I've once heard it said, I don't know if this is true or not, that when you move to a new place, you should consume lots of local honey to accustom yourself to the pollen and other such things.
Could you apply the concept of occasionalism and axiomatic theory, prehension on this context here.
Actually, I don't think I've heard that theory before. That would deserve a different name from occasionalism, I think.
I might be wrong.
No, but it's an interesting theory. The idea that there will be a barrier between God and objects. Whereas occasionalism is the idea that objects themselves cannot touch. They're mediated through gods.
Yeah.
But I'm fascinated by this model you just suggested, where God is the only thing that cannot touch objects. I've never heard that. But occasionalism actually started in Islamic philosophy, which I didn't know until I moved here and started becoming familiar with Islamic philosophy so that I wouldn't be ignorant in the face of my students when they ask questions about it. It began with the so-called Asharites, who were a fairly reactionary group. There was a passage in the Quran about the battle, and it's strange to talk about this in a Coptic area, but a passage in the Quran about the Battle of Badr, where the Muslims defeated the infidels against all odds. And it said, "You think that you threw the stone, but truly it was Allah who threw the stone, who killed the enemy." And the usual reading of this is just this battle was miraculous, God intervened in this battle. But the Asharites read this in a broader sense as meaning that everything is Allah who does it instead of you. So it's actually Allah who's sorting the plastic. It's Allah who is allowing our voices to be heard by each other. And God is the centerpiece of everything. And this had a fairly long life in the Islamic world for many centuries before it came into Europe through Descartes and the Cartesians, where it was a matter of using God to communicate between mind and body. And in the case of Malebranche, between body and body as well. And this died off after Berkeley, I guess, is probably the last occasionalist in early modern period in the West. But I argue that it lives on in the works of human Kant. Because for human Kant, causation is also not directly experienced. The human mind is the mediator for all causation. Not God, but the human mind. So in the case of Hume, causation is simply a habit, the customary conjunction between one appearance and another. In the case of Kant, causation is explicitly a category of the understanding. It doesn't necessarily exist in the outside world. So what I say is that human Kant have merely secularized the occasionalist concept by shifting it from God to human mind. And so it really is still at the heart of Western philosophy, even if we laugh about the old theistic occasionalism now. It's still very much at the heart of Western philosophy, and Hume and Kant are also, I would say, the earliest philosophers who are still respectable, in the sense that you can literally be a Humean or literally be a Kantian, and no one's going to make fun of you in a philosophy department. Whereas if you're literally a Spinozist, that seems a little weird, literally a Leibnizian, it just seems a little too crazy for people. So those are really, unless you're a Catholic or a Thomist, literally, Hume and Kant are probably the earliest ones who you could say are right about most questions. There was another thing. Oh. Then occasionalism comes back in the 20th century in its traditional form through Whitehead, because Whitehead also routes all relations through God. Bruno Latour, who is a great admirer of Whitehead, is also an occasionalist, I argue in that essay. Because Latour also says that every relation must have a mediator. And even though Latour is in some sense more religious as a person than Whitehead was, he does not have the habit of bringing God in to solve philosophical problems. That's not a Latourian gesture. He doesn't do that. It has its own mode of existence. It doesn't contaminate the others. So I think Latour makes a big step forward by what I call secularizing causation by taking it away from any one privileged entity like God of the mind and giving it to every entity. Every entity can be a mediator. And then I have some of the criticisms to make about that, but I think it's an important step forward, and I think it may be Latour's greatest contribution to philosophy, for which he'll be remembered. I think mediation between relations is a real problem.
Can you bring that together with the concept of Oetker describing the tick, the life cycle of a tick, the famous one? How is this process described in Oetker's thinking, and how would Whitehead describe the tick circle, the life circle of a tick?
Whitehead would tend to see the tick as constituted by its relations, and it's making a creative advance because of these relations. I'm very skeptical of this because I don't think you can do everything in terms of relations. And what I like about Uxtrul is that there's a certain non-relation that characterizes the animal. The environment is relational, but the surroundings, the Umgebung, is itself not relational. Well, Umwelt is the one that we can communicate, but the Umgebung surrounds the Umwelt.
Oh.
And that's the thing we cannot have access to. There's an Umgebung, and then every animal is stuck within its own Umwelt within the Umgebung. The one problem I have with...
So the Umwelt is the concept, the interior one?
Yes.
And the Umgebung is the realization?
The Umgebung is simply the larger surrounding in which everybody is. So we and the flies are all in the same Umgebung here, but we're in very different Umwelten because we don't have the organs the fly does and vice versa. And so we're inside of our different Umwelts as if in bubbles that can't communicate. We're all inside the same Umgebung. That's the terminology he uses in the foray into the world of humans and animals. What I worry about in Uxkull's account is that he doesn't account for our ability to get out of that bubble, which we can sometimes. This is a problem I also see in Luhmann and in Macaron Andrello. There's too much emphasis on closure.
Yep.
And I don't think evolution, for one thing, would be possible if there wasn't some openness to what's beyond the usual construction of the organism. There has to be a possible openness to what's outside in order for an animal to evolve. And certainly in the human case, in order for humans to learn, we have to be able to get outside of what we currently know. So I'm not quite as pessimistic about this closure as someone like Uxkull or Luhmann would be.
Yeah, so we've got the possibility to broaden
yes.
things in all worlds, or the concept yes. of all worlds, yes.
Yes, we can bring new things into our umwelt.
Yeah.
I just don't think it can be done directly. I think it has to be done indirectly, metaphorically, or some other way.
Yeah. What about nature in this place? Do you perceive nature, how would you describe nature here? In this location, in this umwelt or umgebung?
Like many people influenced by the tour, I'm skeptical of the concept of nature because I don't think we should view humans as having this awesome power to contaminate everything they touch. We've always been intertwined with nature to some extent. Even before the Anthropocene, we were exhaling carbon dioxide, and this influenced nature as we know it. I was also very struck by some of the remarks in Jared Diamond's Guns, Germs, and Steel, where he says things like that 90% of almonds are toxic in nature. Humans cultivate them to make them all edible. Or that apples, I didn't realize this until reading, that apples are generally not edible. They involve so much complicated grafting between the trees in order for apples to be edible. Strawberries in nature are these tiny little stubby whitish-pink things that even birds barely want to eat. Humans have created these giant fat red strawberries that are so delicious and which seem so natural to us compared to candy flavors. So I try not to get too romantic about nature. However, I love the idea of nature as a relatively fresh background that can restore our sense of being able to detach ourselves from the human artificial environment. So I love going to parks, I love hiking in the mountains, and all of these things. So I don't want to throw it away too quickly, but I'm skeptical of the deep ecological notion that we need a nature completely uncontaminated by humans, because I don't think humans have that power.
That's a good place to meet at Al-Azhar Park, since this is a garbage, a trash mountain, which
yeah.
has a very thin layer mm-hmm. of this 1001 night stream
yes.
built on it and performed every day. Maybe last question,
okay.
intercorporality, we dealt with it in our artistic research, the concept by Merleau-Ponty, the intercorporeality between subjects, but also between subjects and objects. How would you think that Merleau-Ponty term of Zwischenleiblichkeit in German with prehension, and or maybe make it more concrete, intercorporeality here, mm-hmm. where do you observe it right now?
I should begin by saying that my one disappointment with Merleau-Ponty is that he has self and world and self and self, but he doesn't do world and worlds. And this is typical of most of the post-Kantian philosophers, because for them the self-world relation has primacy over all the others. All the others have to be filtered through that. So if I'm talking about the relation of fire and cotton ball, it's I who I'm talking about that, and therefore it's actually a human relation. But no, I think we have to be able to talk about the object-object relation just as we talk about the subject-object or subject-subject relations. And this is why I'm always somewhat skeptical of Merleau-Ponty's implicit claim to be a very futuristic thinker. I think there's a lot of old-fashioned idealism in him. He says, the world looks at me just as I look at it, but why do parts of the world not look at each other? It seems too focused on the subject. In terms of intercorporeality here, obviously there's an entwining of humans and objects here, and at least on a causal level, there's an entwining of different physical objects here, but I'm not sure I see anything yet especially flashes out at me is...
Between the two?
Well, since we're dealing with artificial objects here, our attention is naturally drawn to the human relation to these things. I suppose the way to look for the non-human aspects of these things would be to look for surprising effects. Here's one possibility. The specific garbage patch, I think the speculation has been raised that maybe the specific garbage patch will turn out to be an incubator for whole new types of bacteria and shrimp and things that might thrive under those circumstances, in which case, isn't it early and we have never been modern that Latour says there's a tire dump in France or a garbage dump that turns out to be a home for a rare sort of snail, and so environmentalists are protesting to keep the dump open, kind of contrary to expectations. I expect a lot of phenomena like that, that people turn out to be on the wrong side without realizing it.
We are also very much inspired by the concept of the parasite by Michel Serre.
Mm-hmm.
And this helps thinking that. In our cells, we've got a part which has been a parasite before, and then it got integrated, and we use it in every human cell now as a feature, which improves our immune system and so on. And I think this, are you familiar with a parasite?
I'm familiar, quite familiar with Lynn Margulis's take on this, and I don't know if she cited it in Michel Serre's book or not, but Margulis has the idea of serial endosymbiosis theory, which is that the cells in the human body do in fact represent a symbiosis of more primitive constituents, some of which are viruses or bacteria, which began as parasites feasting on our nutrients, then reproduced along with our cells, which ultimately became crucial to our survival because they insulated us against the harmful effects of oxygen in the atmosphere as it increased. And her hypothesis in the 60s was that if we could test the DNA in the cell nucleus, we're going to find that a lot of the parts of the cell are not coded for because they're not supposed to be there. They are parasites that adapted themselves to us. And apparently it turned out in the 1980s that this is true. So I find that quite fascinating. And in fact, in my recent book, Immaterialism, I use symbiosis as the principle of historical analysis. That you shouldn't analyze historical objects, like I talked about the Dutch East India Company there, because Leibniz makes fun of it and says it's not a real object, so I wanted to defend it. And I said the Dutch East India Company cannot be defined by its actions the way actor network theory would want to do. It can only be defined by its symbioses, because not all of its actions are equally important. Mm. Just as all the actions of a cell are not equally important. The important ones are the ones where it symbiosizes, whatever the verb is, with some other creature. That's a change in its life history. The same for historical objects, I argue. And I ended up concluding that all objects have about 5 or 6 symbioses before they begin to rise and then decline.
It's a permanent process. You have to perceive it in on a time level, on a long time level.
Yes. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Okay. When does the thing? Last question.
Sure.
When does the thing turn to waste? When does your plastic bag turn to waste? When does your watch turn to waste? Your bottle?
Well, I suppose.
When does an object turn to waste?
I suppose it turns to waste when it detaches itself from its use value or detaches itself from its surroundings. Which is interesting because for me an object is precisely what it is when it detaches itself from its surroundings. So in a sense, object and waste are two sides of the same coin because there's a non-relational aspect to both of them. Although I guess in the case of waste, it still is connected to its surroundings in a negative sense, in the sense that it hinders those surroundings and needs to be cleared, needs to be taken out.
Mm-hmm.
But then of course, much like cliches or like last week's news, waste can reverse into treasure later.
Yep.
I would love to see a garbage dump from Neolithic times, and so would any archaeologist. They love finding these things, as you mentioned.
Yeah, thank you.
Middens.
So we give them plenty of things to do.
Yes.
Within 100 or 1,000 years from now.
Yes.
Okay, thank
you. Well, thank
you. Very
interesting, and thank you for bringing me to this wonderful place.
Cool.
All right. It's good because my leg was starting to fall asleep from that crate.
So you just arrived in Egypt? Since you're talking about jet lag, or?
Yeah, about a week and a half ago.
A week and a half, yeah. And it takes its time, yeah, to get used to it.
Yeah.
We will drive you back to Asha Park, is that okay?
I'd rather be taken to a place where there are a lot of taxis, because I'm not sure there were taxis waiting out there. Were there?
There are.
Oh, okay.
Yeah?
That's fine then.
So we bring you outside of the town,
because
there are no taxis in here.
Ah, yeah, it's impossible.
Okay, great. Okay, we're finished.
There are these little rickshaws in here, but I don't.
Yeah, it's okay. Hey,
start it. You're going to show us the machine?
Yeah. The setting machine would be too loud for us.
Oh, too long.
It would be a too strong parasite for our conversation.
Oh, okay. Yeah, I've got a busy day ahead of me too, even though it's Friday.
Yeah. Okay, great.
I got a Skype interview and I got an article to finish.
Ah, okay.
Whoa. Look at that.